Alright, the next major topic that we are going to take up is the design of adder. But before we get to that, there is one last issue with regard to timing analysis that I just want to cover very quickly. So, the question is essentially this: consider a circuit like this, okay? Don't worry about how it came about or why someone would construct such a circuit. Just assume that such a circuit has, for some reason, been constructed. So there are two inputs to this and two outputs. The inputs are A and B, the outputs are Y and Z. Okay. Now assume that every gate, whether it's an inverter, AND gate or gate, has a delay equal to one time unit. Okay. Just call it time units. I don't care whether it's nanoseconds or picoseconds or hundreds of picoseconds, doesn't matter. It's one time unit. Okay. Now the question is, what is the critical path through this circuit? How long is it? No, I mean this is critical path, right? So the longest and what do you mean it depends on the output? No, but for the entire circuit, so which one is it? A to Z, right? How many people agree that it is A to Z is the critical path over here? Okay, so the majority thinks that this is the case. And that's pretty much correct. From the viewpoint of static timing analysis, that is the correct answer, right? You have four gates. So this essentially turns out to be the critical path as far as the circuit is concerned. By the way, coming back to that statement, when I'm asking for the critical path of a complete circuit, it is the worst among all paths. So it does not really depend on the output. You have to consider among all outputs which is the worst. Right? Alright, so in this case, this pretty clearly is the longest path. It is the critical path. Inverter and or switch four time units. Okay. But what I am claiming over here is that the actual critical path is only three time units long. Okay. And this path, which is of four time units, is actually a so called false path. Okay, so now let's understand why it would be a false path. Okay, now what does it require for a signal to go from A to Z? What should be the series of transitions that we have over here? It has to be reflected from A to Z. Right, so I want some signal which is at A, some transition at A, either 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, to come all the way through to Z. Right? Only then will the propagation delays of all the four gates, the inverter, the AND gate and the OR gate will get accumulated. The question is, can that ever happen? Is there any problem that you can see over here as far as that kind of a transition is concerned? Let's take a specific example. A is going from 0 to 1. What will happen at the intermediate value after A, after the first inverter? What will be the transition that you see? 1 to 0. Okay? After the second inverter, the transition is going to be once again 0 to 1. Okay? I want this transition, the 0 to 1 transition at the second inverter, to go through the AND gate. Right? What should be the other input to the AND gate for that to happen? It has to be a 1. What will happen is the other input to the AND gate was a 0. It doesn't matter what changes occur over here, nothing is going to go through the AND gate. Right? So in other words, a 0 input to an AND gate is called a controlling value. As soon as one of the inputs is 0, the output of the AND gate is guaranteed to be 0, doesn't matter what happens to the other input. Okay? And conversely, a 1 at the input of an AND gate is a non-controlling value. Okay? So if I have a 1 over here, it's a non-controlling input to the AND gate, and whatever transition I had, 0 to 1 in this case, or even if it had been 1 to 0, it doesn't really matter, is allowed to propagate through the AND gate. Right? If the input, if the second input to the AND gate had been a 0, then it doesn't matter what happens on the two inverters before that, they cannot propagate through the AND gate. Okay? Alright, so now what we have said is, this line over here, this value, let me call it x, must be equal to 1. What does that imply for the output of the OR gate? As far as the OR gate is concerned, what is the controlling value for the OR gate? A 1 at the input is going to be a controlling value. Right? If any of the inputs to our OR gate is equal to 1, automatically the output of the OR gate is going to be equal to 1. Right? So effectively what we have over here is, as long as x is equal to 0, or rather x is equal to 1, the output of the OR gate is automatically going to be equal to 1. Or in other words, what I required over here was that x is equal to 0 for that transition to propagate through the OR gate. Right? For the transition at A to propagate through AND, x must be equal to 1, and through OR, x must be equal to 0. So we have a problem, there is a contradiction here. X cannot be both 0 and 1 at the same time. Right? Which means that this particular path, starting from A, passing through two inverters, through the AND gate and through the OR gate, can never actually be exercised in practice. Okay? In a real situation, you can never have the condition that x is equal to both 0 and 1 at the same time. Therefore, either the AND gate is passing data through, in which case the OR gate value is already equal to 1, the OR gate output is already equal to 1, or the OR gate is so called sensitized, right? The OR gate is not controlled, right? But in that case, the AND gate is then controlled, and its output is automatically equal to 0. Okay? So at any given point in time, only one of these two transitions can, one of these two conditions can hold. Because of that, this particular path which I have marked in red over here can never be the active path. Okay? So it cannot be the critical path. Okay? This kind of a path is called a false path. It is something which, when we do static timing analysis, that is, we don't care about the type of the gate and we just do the propagation of arrival time, right? When we are just doing propagation of arrival times without worrying about the type of the gate, it is the longest path. But the moment you take the actual logic into consideration, we can see that this path can never be exercised. Okay? Hence it is a false path. Okay? So this is one of the sort of additional considerations that you need to take into account when you are actually finding the longest path to a circuit or the critical path of a circuit. Okay? Unfortunately, the problem of finding false paths in general is a so-called NP-complete problem, which means that it is a computationally hard problem. Okay? So, in general, finding all the false paths in a circuit is a very hard problem. Given a particular path through a circuit, it is possible to find out whether or not it's a false path. So, there are techniques for that, right? Basically, what we did over here was so-called sensitization of the path, right? What I wanted to see is it possible for a signal at the input, at A, to come through to Z? Okay? What input can I apply to the other gates in the circuit such that the change in input at A will be seen at Z? Okay? Now, this is a problem which is studied in the concept of testability and observability of circuits, and there are algorithms which can be used in order to find out whether or not that is possible. So, given a particular path through a circuit, it is possible to say whether or not it can be sensitized. Right? Sensitized meaning, can I check the values of all the inputs in such a way that the final output can be observed properly? Okay? But in general, finding out what are the non-fault paths in a circuit and among those finding the critical path is a hard problem. Okay? So, the usual technique of timing analysis, the so-called difference between static timing analysis which does not care about functionality of the gate versus so-called functional timing analysis, considers the analysis without false paths. In general, this is a difficult problem to solve. Okay? You can either do it. So, one of the things that could be done over here is, given a particular set of inputs, I could always have propagated those inputs, like I did over here, right? Let's say that A has gone from 0 to 1, I propagate that, and the output of that first inverter, the output will go from 1 to 0. Second inverter, output will go from 0 to 1. And gate will propagate the signal or not. Okay? This process, what I did over here, is called simulation. I am effectively taking a certain set of sample inputs and propagating it through the circuit. Okay, I am simulating the circuit under the conditions of those inputs. Simulation is also fairly straightforward to do. I mean, it is a slightly more complex problem than static timing analysis, but the same kind of principles hold over there as well. So, simulation could be considered one other way of sort of finding, you know, whether a particular input will cause a timing violation or not. The problem is you can do this for one input or for two inputs or even for 10 inputs or 10,000 inputs. In general, the number of possible inputs for a large circuit can be much larger than that. Okay? So it's not in general possible to do it for all possible inputs for a circuit. So simulation is not guaranteed to find out all possible paths through a circuit, or rather to exercise all possible paths through a circuit, and therefore give you the longest possible path. It is guaranteed to never hit a false path, right? Because false path will never be hit by simulation, or rather will be avoided by simulation. The moment that it is false, the signal will get cut off at that point. Okay? So static timing analysis does not care about the functionality of the circuit, straight away does an analysis from end to end. Simulation cares completely about the functionality of the circuit but cannot catch all possible paths. Functional timing analysis in general is a hard problem, which is a combination of both of these conditions. Okay? Alright. So with that, that sort of ends our discussion of timing analysis for the time being. The next topic that I'm going to go to, from here onwards, what we are going to do is take up a certain set or certain classes of circuits that are useful in practice and look at many different implementations for those. Okay? In the process, we will focus on certain kinds of circuits where it brings out some architectural aspects of the design. What I mean by architectural aspects is it's not completely at the transistor level. There are certain other considerations that you can take to sort of move to a higher level of abstraction and do the design and sort of verify, sort of get a better understanding for whether or not these circuits are complex or what is the best critical path that can be achieved or what are ways by which they can be improved in this. The first type of circuits that we consider are adders. So, adders are just circuits that help you to add numbers to this. Okay? So, we are going to assume that you have the generic binary representation of numbers. You want to add them together. Now, for that, of course, we will eventually be considering numbers that are maybe 8 bits or 16 bits or 32 bits wide and trying to add them together. But before that, the first question becomes, how do you do addition in binary? Right? At a single digit or a single bit level. What are the components you know of which are used for addition at the binary level? I'm hearing a lot of mumbling. Somebody give a clear answer. OR and XOR, but they are used in order to build certain other kinds of modules. Right? What are those modules? Half adders and full adders. Okay. Over here I'm not even going to bother with half adders because a half adder is a subset of a full adder. Okay. So let's first consider what a full adder does. And then based on that is what we are going to be doing the rest of our analysis. Okay. So the basic full adder circuit essentially takes three inputs, right? There is an A input, a B input, and a carry input. Okay? And it has two outputs. One is the sum and the other is the carry output. Now, what are the basic equations which determine the relationship between the sum and the carry out versus the input? Okay. So, we can write down the equations for those. The sum bit is given by the XOR of all three inputs, right? A, XOR, B, XOR. Right. One way of understanding it is to say that the sum bit will be true when the number of 1 in A, B and C put together is odd. Right? Because if I add up an odd number of 1, then I get either 1 or 3 as the result. In either case, the sum bit which is coming out at that particular position has to be a 1. There may or may not be a carry. Okay? So the XOR precisely calculates that. It says either A alone is 1, or B alone is 1, or C alone is 1, or all three of them are equal to 1. Those are the conditions under which the XOR operation, the 3 input XOR, is going to be equal to 1. Okay? The carry out, on the other hand, is given by either A and B are high and C is don't care. right? At that point, once A and B are high, it means C can be either 0 or 1, it doesn't matter, there's a carry out at this stage. Okay? Or B and C are high, or A and C are high. Right? This automatically takes care of the condition that A, B, C are all high. Okay? This type of gate is also called a majority gate. For obvious reasons, it's looking for the majority among A, B, and C. If the majority of A, B, C is equal to 1, that is 2 out of 3 are equal to 1 or 3 out of 3 are equal to 1, then the output is equal to 1. Otherwise, the minority comes through. Right? If the majority is 0, then the output is going to be 0. If the majority is 1, then the output is going to be 1. Okay? So now comes the question, how do we implement such circuits? Okay, or before that, there are a couple of things that we can observe about these equations which help us with implementing them. Okay? One of them is that these equations, both of them, the sum as well as the carry out, the equations for those, are so called mirror symmetric. They are inversion symmetric. Okay, what do I mean by that? Supposing I invert all the three inputs, A, B, and C, and feed them into the sum equation, right? So what does it previously say? That A or B or C, any one of them or all three must be equal to 1, then the output is equal to 1. Supposing I invert all three and give it, right? Effectively what it's going to say is any one or all three must be equal to 0, then the output will be 0. Okay? The equation becomes completely symmetric. F bar is equal to A bar XOR B bar XOR C bar. This is not true in general, right? Supposing I take an AND gate, A and B, and feed in A bar and B bar, what I get is not AND bar at the output, right? A bar ANDed with B bar is A plus B the whole bar, not A dot B the whole bar. Whereas over here, this condition is satisfied. Okay? And you can verify separately that this is also satisfied. So symmetric under the inversion of the input. That is, once you invert the input, it just implements the same function but the inversion of that. Okay? Now this is used, that symmetry property is used in certain kinds of architecture. Okay? Another interesting property of this is the fact that the sum which is equal to A XOR B XOR C can also be written as this. Okay? I am not proving it over here. You can verify that this equation is in fact correct. It's a little tricky, but you can go ahead and check this. Okay? So sum is equal to ABC plus CO bar into A plus B plus C. Okay? We'll see later where this particular structure becomes useful. Okay? So now, anyway, we have got these equations, we want to implement them. The question is, how do I implement something like XOR in CMOS logic? Okay? It's a bit tricky because the equation for XOR, A XOR B is A B bar plus A bar B. Okay? So it's not a very straightforward thing to implement in CMOS logic because you need to first invert the B before feeding it into the input and altogether that equation can be a little bit messy. Unless you sort of observe carefully what exactly it is trying to implement and straight away go ahead and implement the final equation. Okay? So it turns out that if we look at an equation something like this, let's consider the pull down network alone first. Okay, I'm just going to draw the network first and then we'll later get into the analysis. So what are all the conditions under which, I mean, let's just do the analysis, okay, of this one. This is the pull down network alone. Right? A, B, C bar is one path which can pull this down. Okay? A, B bar, C, C bar. Oh, sorry. Yeah. This is the C. Okay. A, B bar, C. It's the second part. Right? The third one goes through this A bar, B bar, C bar, and the final one is A bar, B, C. Okay? Not of this is what is being implemented. So effectively the pull down, in other words, has directly implemented the XOR structure. The tricky bit over here is I need to also generate the A bar, B bar, C bar signals. For that I'll have to use separate inverter. Right? I cannot just use the A, B, C signals alone and implement the logic. I also need to get A bar, B bar and C bar. Okay? So this directly implements the XOR logic that we have over here, right? The question is, what does the pull-up network look like? It turns out that the pull-up network is also identical in terms of CMOS transistors. Okay? So, what I'm going to do over here is, I'm not going to draw the entire structure. I'm going to refer to the textbook by Vesey, Harris and Banerjee. Okay? I'm using a lot of figures from there for the purpose of illustration in class. Okay? This PDF will also be put up on the class notes, but please make sure you know you don't distribute these things without permission because they are taken directly from the book and they are meant only for circulation inside the class. Okay? Of course, you can also refer directly to the book for all these figures. This is the structure that we have over here. Right? So what this does is, it completes the diagram that we had earlier. Right? So what you can see is This is the pull-up network, this is the pull-down network. They are both completely symmetric in terms of how they look and how the inputs are connected. But if you go through all the different paths and work out what exactly is the logic that is being implemented, you can verify two things. First is that it implements the XOR function as required. The second is, this is a completely static circuit. Okay? What do you mean by static? For any combination of inputs, there is a direct pull down or pull up path. One of them alone is active. At the same time, you will not have both pull up and pull down active. Right? But at any given time, one of them will be active. So it will never be a dynamic sort of floating gate, floating output situation where both pull up and pull down are cut off. That will also never happen. Okay? So how do you come up with a circuit like this? Basically by observing the equations, finding the symmetries in it and implementing the logic. This is not a straightforward case of CMOS logic design where we just implemented something from the logic equation. We have to actually implement it by observing the symmetry in the circuit. Okay? Now on this side, we also have the equation for the carry out. Right? Once again, if you look at it, what is happening is you have the different paths, C bar A bar, C bar B bar and A bar B bar. Okay? And because the pull down network is inverted to get the output, you effectively have the actual thing is C out which is being implemented. Okay? So all the three different paths have been implemented. All that you have done is share one of the transistors as far as the C pull down is concerned. Okay. Now, this is a very important observation as far as these kind of designs in general are concerned. When you are trying to design basic elements, you want as far as possible for the final structure to be symmetric. Right? And to have some degree of regularity because that makes your layout much easier. Okay? Now, by following the equation which we saw over here, this particular equation, we can also come up with another implementation of the same logic. Right? Over here, what have we done? This part of it, the minority part, essentially implements the AB plus BC plus CA logic. That then goes out over here as C out. And then we use that same C out to go through this logic to come through as the sum. Okay? Both are different kinds of implementations of, and both are essentially using the same principle in order to implement the logic. You notice how symmetric the entire structure is. Right? So in other words, this is not the kind of CMOS logic that we are familiar with where the pull-up network will be the dual of the pull-down network. In this case, it is not obvious that they are duals of each other. Right? It turns out that they are dual in nature in the sense that when one is 0, the other is 1 and vice versa. Right? But in structure at least, they are not obviously duals of each other. Okay? One thing you will notice from this particular implementation is that the C out, if I ask you to compute the propagation delay from the input, that is A, B, C, to C out and to S, which one do you think is going to be larger? Huh? I'm just asking, I give the three inputs over here. I have two things. One is propagation delay to this point, propagation delay to this point. Which one is going to be larger? The delay to S is going to be larger. Right? That's pretty obvious because effectively once I have computed this particular point over here, to get Pout, I only have one additional inverter. Whereas I have a whole bunch of extra gates or extra transistors before the S input can be computed, S output can be computed. Okay? So the question is, why would you use something of that sort? Right? We'll get to the answer for that later once we find out the critical path of a complete multiple bit adder circuit. Okay? Now a related thing, which once again is just, I'm putting it up here for illustration reference, is this is once again from the textbook, right? This is the layout of a complete full adder cell. Okay? So you can see how they have made it quite elegant looking at the end of the day, right? Even though there is a lot of transistors over there, the way that it has been laid out and the way that the structure has been done, you just have clean lines for A, B and C running through, and all the transistors are constructed around them. Okay? All of that entire logic which was there for generating the sum as well as the Cout is captured within this much space. Okay? So because of that, one of the things that you will find is, in standard cell library, apart from the regular AND gates, OR gates and so on, very often the full adder and half adder themselves are also elements in a standard cell library. Now if you look at this, this is going to be much larger than a NAND gate. Okay, much larger than the layout of a NAND gate. But much smaller than what you would get if you use discrete NAND gates in order to construct the complete logic for a full adder. Okay, and given that adder and derived from them multipliers and so on are some of the most common types of logic or circuit structures that are commonly implemented, it turns out that it is useful to actually spend time optimizing the full adder structure. Okay. Now, apart from these, so what we have seen so far is the implementations of adder directly in terms of the equation, okay. Yet another way by which they can be directly implemented in terms of those equations is to use so-called CTL, complementary pass transistor logic. CTL or CTTL. Okay. How does this work? Once again, you have the different paths that we have over here. An example is, this is ABC bar. Right? Similarly, you can trace the different paths through this entire structure and find out what is the actual equation being implemented as S and S bar. Right? One thing to keep in mind over here, this circuitry in the middle, the two PMOS transistors, that is not strictly speaking necessary, but it serves two purposes. One is, under the condition that the so effectively what these two CMOS transistors do is to make sure that they speed up the transition at the S and S bar inverter input. Okay? They are effectively something like DC DSL. Right? So what you have done over there is, so by the way, this is VDD, not ground. Okay? Then this is connected to VDD like this. What happens is those two CMOS transistors serve precisely the same purpose as what is used in DC DSL. Right? The difference between DC DSL and this is that the A and A bar are directly given as input. So these are pass transistors. These are not the just the pull down networks that are used in DC DSL. They are actually used as pass transistors. But the pull up path is also added over here just for speeding up the circuit implementation. Right? So this is yet another way by which you can implement these. The CTL based method is slightly faster in general than the other CMOS type of structure that we have. There are trade-offs. So one of them is faster, one uses more transistors, right? the sizing of the transistors also becomes an issue. In general, you retain the 2:1 ratio as far as the PMOS to NMOS is concerned. And that's about it. You don't, you know, the design can then be optimized in various ways. Okay? Alright. So, those are sort of the three basic structures that we have as far as different kinds of direct implementation of the adder from the equations is concerned. Okay? Now, what happens when we try building a multi-bit adder? So what I mean by a multi-bit adder is, I have two numbers. And maybe some carry input. I want to get the sum output, S1, S2, S3, S4. And I want to find out whether or not there is an overall carry out for this circuit. So this is addition of two 4-bit numbers. Okay. Now the question becomes, how do I implement a multi-bit adder using basic full adder cells? Right? And the structure, the full adder itself is constructed in such a way that building a multi-bit adder is very easy by using full adder cells. Okay. Effectively what we have over there is, I'll take the first full adder, feed in A1 and B1 and the C input. The sum output of this comes here, the carry out, which I will call C1, goes to the next stage. So C4 is equal to C out of the entire 4-bit block. Okay? If there is a carry out at the last stage, it essentially means that that is to be taken forward to some other, let's say that you are trying to add 8-bit numbers instead, it is to be fed forward to the 5th-bit, 6th-bit and so on. Okay? So in general, this is the structure that we have. Using 4 full adder cells, I have managed to do addition of 4 bits at a time. Okay. A4 to A1 is the first number, where A4 is the most significant bit, A1 is the least significant bit. B4 to B1 is another number. Okay. And the result comes out, S4 to S1 is the actual sum, and there is also a carry out which indicates whether or not there was an overflow, whether it went beyond 4, whether the final result goes beyond 4 bits or not. Okay. Now, this is fairly straightforward. It allows us to directly implement the logic using the kind of structures that we looked at earlier. What will be the critical path through this circuit? Up to C out, right? So effectively it will be something like this. There is a, in the worst case, there is a possibility that the inputs are something like this. And I try adding these numbers together, right? Or I could even have, in fact, Yeah, okay, let's just consider this. There is also a possibility that both the inputs, that the second input is 0 and the carry in comes in over there. Right? I add these two numbers together, I get 0, carry 1, 1 and 1, I get 0, carry 1, 1 and 1, once again I get 0, I carry 1, 1 and 1 I get 0 and I carry 1 over to this case. Right? So effectively what has happened in this case is, I have got a critical path which goes through this chain, through all of these, and finally comes through, will it be to the C out or the S4? If you actually look at the structure that we had earlier, right, if we look at this kind of architecture for example, the delay to X is going to be larger, okay? But it of course depends on the way that you have implemented it, but in general it could be to either one of them, right? In general, the S computation is slightly more complex because it is the XOR operation as compared to the C computation, which is basically ABC and AB plus BC plus CA. Right? So typically what you find is that the delay, even if you did not use that CO bar into A plus B plus C plus ABC expression for sum, the propagation delay from input up to the sum output is typically greater than that for the propagation delay from the input to the carry out. Okay? So the critical path is essentially going to be something like this. Okay? Which starts all the way at the input, passes through every one of the cells and finally comes through to the output. Okay? Now, in the case where we implemented the logic using some structure like this, using this kind of a structure, right? What we are doing is we are generating the C bar and the S bar and then putting inverters at the end of it in order to once again invert the value and get the correct output, right? The correct S and C output. But remember what we said about supposing I invert all the inputs to the full adder, I get the inversion of the output as well. Okay? So that's another trick that we could use over here and implement. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the complemented values of the output. Those bubbles over there indicate that take the complemented values of the output. Feed this in here. So in other words, what I get over here is actually S1 bar. How do I get S1 from that? Put an inverter, but that's okay. That's not a problem. Right? Anyway, I have saved some inverter somewhere else because I have not put an inverter inside the full adder logic. Over here, feed A2 bar and B2 bar. Okay? This is C1 bar that is being fed in here. What happens? What will be the result that you get out here? It will actually be S2. Right? Not because it's S2 bar, bar. I have complemented the input and fed them into something and I am not complementing the final output. So this will actually be S2 itself. Okay? So here I feed A3, B3. Once again I get S3 bar and C3 bar. Here in A4 bar and B4 bar over here. S4 here. Okay. Now, to fix the result, you obviously have to put inverters over here. And to implement this, you actually need to of course implement, you know, all the inverters and so on. But the point is, these extra inverters that you are putting on the A paths and so on are not on your critical path. What you have taken out is a whole bunch of inverters which were there on your critical path. Right? One inverter from here. So at each of the outputs I have saved one inverter. This is not from the point of view of area, but rather from the point of view of delay that it is important. Okay? So overall this has resulted in a slightly lower end-to-end delay than what it was earlier. Okay? This kind of a structure, which is the most common type of, or rather the most basic type of adder structure, is called a ripple carry adder. Okay. The reason it's called ripple carry is because of this behavior that we see over here. The first input in turn ripples through to the second one. It's like waves spreading in a pond, right? You drop a stone in water, it causes a wave to spread up. In the same way, the first one sends out a wave that in turn triggers the next one, that triggers the next one, that triggers the next one, so it ripples through the entire surface. Okay? Because of that, this kind of a structure is called a ripple carry adder. It is the most basic kind of adder structure. Okay? We'll stop here for now. Tomorrow we'll look at various different kinds of adder structures and ways of making this faster.